Ladies and gentlemen, I just like to say that if we start off this new era of WWE the way we did this past week, the world of World Wrestling Entertainment is in good hands. But right now, you're in good hands as well, because you are dealing with the fastest rising show on UPR, and that would be the Smackdown Penitentiary. Ladies and gentlemen, I am your host, one of your hosts, Zia Solid, your co-host right there, Vic. Vic, how you doing, brother? How was your week?
Chilling, fam. Welcome to the penitentiary.
Yes, sir. So real quick, somebody took out my penitentiary. No, they didn't. Ladies and gentlemen, because I know y'all here for it, here you go.
Welcome to the Smackdown Penitentiary.
There you go. Now we can properly start this thing. Now, I didn't get a chance to speak to you about Mania. What was your thoughts on Mania? Since we got the late show, we're 6 days removed from night one.
Well, all right. Number one, I was supposed to go and then I couldn't go. So I was that I couldn't go. So, you know, I went into it just being sad, period, because the show was amazing. Great job. You really did. Everything was good.
What was your favorite match? Outside of any of the main events?
I mean, okay, well, outside of the main events, well, I mean, the six-man tag, like, I thought that was interesting, especially with the two guys coming in out of nowhere, because it was predicted, like, I thought that Rey Mysterio was going to give Santos the rub and, you know, let him win that match and continue the feud, right? Or something where Carlito was going to get involved and, you know what I mean? So, like, I enjoyed it because it was a huge swerve from what's normal. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So, Monday Night Raw got a nice, like, got a nice pop.
It was a massive swerve from what's normal when it comes to.
Yeah. So Monday night had a good, had a good post Mania, right? And so SmackDown had to follow up. NXT had good post stand to deliver. So, a lot of pressure on SmackDown. There's a lot of pressure on SmackDown. And we start the show off with Cody coming out, obviously. And the thing about this, as I'm watching, right? Cody Rhodes doesn't seem, I don't know. It feels like Cody doesn't know how to hold a championship. That's the kind of vibe I got from him. Like,
funny.
He can barely get his arm under there because he didn't tighten the strap too tight, right? Like, he's got his belt, right? He's got his belt and he's got it like this. It's so tight. It's so tight. Like, loosen it up, my guy. He can barely get his arm under there. So you can see that, like, he's struggling to, like, keep it straight. And, like, dude, it's too tight under your arm. You gotta loosen that thing up, man. Like, are you a champion or not? I know you practice at home and trying to hold that title a lot by now.
That's true.
What's going on, Jeffrey? Thank you. Listen, we got the A show, the SmackDown Penitentiary. I'm trying to tell him we the fastest rising, we are the fastest high. It's rising consistent. Cody he's definitely getting used to being champion. This ain't the TNT title from AEW.
Fact. But
he comes out there and he's doing, you know, basic Cody stuff that he's always doing. Mike, shout out to Mike, says that you're frozen right now.
I am.
Cody does the basic Cody stuff that he always does, which is pander a lot to the crowd. And he comes out and he says, to basically kind of hint at what Rock gave him. And then says that he's looking forward to him, to Rock coming back, which I think we all are. Some people think that Rock is pulling Bloodline strings as well. We'll get into that a little bit later. But then we find out the main event for spots at the number one contendership, which would end up being two triple threat matches with Lashley, Santos, Escobar, and LA Knight for one bracket. Hello. And then AJ Styles, Kevin Owens, and Rey Mysterio for the other one. And whoever would win those respected matches would go on for a number one contenders match for to see who would be the number one contender going into Backlash to face off against Cody Rhodes. And I'm gonna say this, right? I don't think that for the purposes of the roster that they have constructed right now, is that me and Mike talked about this briefly on a phone call. On a phone call. I don't want Cody's first opponent to be AJ Styles. I don't want it to be Bobby Lashley. Fortunately, Bobby Lashley didn't get through. We'll get into that a little bit later. But whoever you feed Cody to, they're already in a bad position. This ends our first segment, basically setting up the rest of the night. Your thoughts on Cody winning the championship at WrestleMania and going forward? Do you think Cody's a believable champion?
Yeah. Hell yeah, definitely. I mean, look at his whole story, because I mean, you got to remember, most people forget that he was a Ring of Honor champion. You know what I mean? Not that long ago. So, yeah. You know, if you look, especially like all of those wrestling fans that are hardcore in the indie scene and remember how Cody Rhodes, I remember the time when you couldn't say Rhodes. Like, that really wasn't that long ago. So, you know, the
Cody, that was terrible.
Yeah. Like, you know, just that whole thing, and then everything with AEW and everything. I think this guy is the perfect guy to pass the torch to, in my opinion. Yeah. Because of everything with his story. And then the thing is, like, he's so over, he's selling a ton of merch. A lot of people love him. So, like, it's a great fit. It's definitely a great fit. And, you know, at the end of the day, like, you know, the Tribal Chief has all of his fans and everything. But, you know, like I've been saying for a long time, the Tribal Chief doesn't need a strap anymore. Really doesn't. He just doesn't. And we're literally about to find out how all of that is going to work. I mean, he'll be gone for a while, but I'm sure he'll definitely make his return at some point.
You see, now, me and Mike Noxia, we're saying we don't think that Roman's going to be gone that long. I mean,
no, probably a couple months.
He posted on his TikTok or whatever that, you know, day one starts now, right? So, and Triple H has already alluded to him coming, you know, having some more layers to his story. So that in itself, right, is, I would believe that. that old ass shit. I believe that. I would say that I would give it, I wouldn't see Roman sitting out past SummerSlam. I think SummerSlam would be, sitting out, not past SummerSlam, but I would see him coming back for something for SummerSlam. But you definitely got to let these other layers of what the Bloodline has without Roman right now. And the key to that is going to be Paul Heyman. Definitely the key to that is Paul Heyman, because he's got to be able to bring
he's got to be able to bring things out of what he has that it's not Roman Reigns, right? So that's the only thing that they have to work on right now while Roman's gone. And it's not going to be Roman that's going to be elevating them. It's going to be Paul Heyman. But speaking
of... that's what Paul Heyman does. You know what I mean? Like, he's the greatest mouthpiece in WWE history, in my opinion. Like, look at that Hall of Fame speech. Who else could get away with all the crap that he got away with in that Hall of Fame speech?
Oh, God.
Like, come on, bro. Come on, bro. Shout out to Rob Van Dam for getting the ability to go there, and Goldust didn't Tommy get Dreamer the ability too. To go.
Huh? And it was on and Tommy Dreamer too. And they appeared on camera.
Word. I mean, and Keith Lee, you know, like with shoulder showed up in the background. Like, but my but you know, the thing is but you know, I'm just curious to see why Goldust wasn't around. But you know,
I think his position of power in AEW is a little too much for Tony Khan to even allow that. I just think, but I thought I seen somebody said that he was at Mania.
Yeah, I mean, going to Mania isn't a thing. I'm talking about being part of the show. You know what I mean? Like Rob Van Dam was clearly there, and the cameras were put on him. And you know, he's not signed to the company, he's not, you know what I'm saying? Like, but he was there. Katie Forbes was there, like, you know. And it might have just been because Rob Van Dam is already a Hall of Famer, and since he mentioned somebody that's been here before, but you know, I just found that whole thing interesting, right? But you know, my whole point about mentioning Paul Heyman is just that, I mean, come on, you think Solo got those mic skills? Come on.
Solo does more with saying less when it's just what he did last night. I think that's just enough. That's just enough for him, which is fine, right? Speaking of that, we get, you know, the more things change, the more they stay the same. But in this instance, as they're thinking they got the double door locker rooms again, you now find out. And Paul says, we lost. Things change when you lose. So yeah. Solo, this is what is dope about Solo's character. A lot of people don't like Solo's character for some reason. Like, some people don't need to be able to talk all the time, right? Like, you don't necessarily need to cut a promo. Right, like you don't have to cut a promo. You could do more with less. And Solo is so serious that his character is that serious. So when he speaks, it's very few little words, but you know he means business, and that's it, right? And just the looks that Paul Heyman gives whenever Solo moves, his like when he moves, when he looks, Paul Heyman is look more frightened looking at Solo Sikoa than he has at Roman Reigns. Like, it's been that way for a while, but this is the genius of Paul Heyman, because he's able to bring that out just by what he's doing, right? Like, Solo could just be doing what he was supposed to do, right, as they rehearsed it, but Paul's reaction is what can get you to believe in somebody. And I believe that within this night alone has made Solo Sikoa more relevant than he's been in months, as far as the Bloodline storyline goes. And I think it's genius how they're doing this. Your thoughts on this small segment that we got from the Bloodline before we got into the big stepper of the night? What was your thoughts on this interaction with them?
I mean, at first it just felt like, all right, you know, they're showing the small changes, because imagine the guy was champion for 3 years. And they had a specific lifestyle, right? So mind you, Solo Sikoa came from NXT and doesn't know anything else. Doesn't know a different locker room. So because ever since he showed up at in Scotland, I think it was. Wait, where was it?
Clash of the Castle, whatever.
Yeah, where was that? That was, I could have sworn it was, I mean, yeah, it was in the UK, but my point is just that ever since he showed up, you know, he's just been behind Roman Reigns, chilling with Roman Reigns, influenced by Roman Reigns. So, you know, he's basically been living the Roman Reigns lifestyle. And now that he's not the champion, you don't get those perks anymore. And Solo doesn't know that. And but now Solo's on something like, oh, yeah, things change. All right. Things change.
Yeah. But so we get them, you know, basically that was before the commercial break. And they're talking. We're thinking, all right. Well, me personally, I'm thinking, okay, this is good. This is good, right? Like, we get Bloodline early on the TV screen, so now we can really see what's going to happen. What's Roman Reigns' next step? Like, where are we going with this? And I'm not going to lie. I had said that there was going to be a new member, but I thought it was going to be debuting at Mania to help with the Bloodline rules, which would have kind of made sense. But I get it. You had to make sure that if you're going to add another layer to the story, that it has to make sense. So I think that, so they're saying it was in Scotland, Clash of the Castle. So when we get the Bloodline, come out there, Paul Heyman starts to talk and, Solo, and this is why Solo is dope, right? Because he just his little mannerism that he did, and when he stops Paul from talking and says there's consequences to losing, right? Mm-hmm. And Paul just looks so shook. Listen, George, yeah, I love this comment. Solo's entrance theme is fucking goated. The camera angle when it shoots back, you get a high arcing view of the arena, but then you see Solo's Titantron and then the lights. Like, it's a really good entrance, right? And so my question is, if he says this to Paul Heyman, you know, there's consequences to losing. How does he feel about Roman losing? Right? Because Paul comes out there and he basically tells the story. And I didn't get this from Mania, but I do get it in totality, saying that he's held in 10 years of frustration for Seth betraying him in the Shield, and he let that overcome. He overcome this. Mike, I don't, when was what? What are you talking about? I can't take the story that Paul is telling when he's saying that Roman took his eye off the ball just to hit Seth with, like, hitting Seth with that chair was more like it was going to be more satisfactory than retaining. I didn't believe that, but there's other ways that you can spin it how you interpreted the match. But Paul chose that direction, which is fine.
Yeah, I think that direction is what causes the conflict between Solo and Roman, because they did the Samoan spike plus the spear at the same time, told him go, and then said to him, get it. You know what I mean? And he was like, I know. You know what I mean? So, like, and then mind you, there's been many stints where you could see that Roman was like a little scared of Solo. You know what I mean? Throughout this entire thing, there was a little bit of foreshadowing with that. I mean, I'm not gonna lie, bro. This whole thing feels like NWO Wolfpack. You know what I'm saying?
It definitely is. It definitely is definitely giving the vibes of NWO Wolfpacking, because and a lot of people are saying that it's going to be, you know, they're thinking of two different bloodline factions. You got Rocks and you got Romans, but I don't want to go too far in the fantasy booking with that, right? Because
I don't even think it's going to go like that, to be honest with you. I got a feeling there's going to be some shit where And not like where they have two different shirts, like Yeet and No Yeet. I think it's just going to be where Solo is just going nuts and then Roman comes back. But then Roman comes back on a babyface push.
Right.
That's what I think is going to happen. Or maybe not, you know what I mean? Or am I? Because I don't see them fighting each other for such a long time, if that makes sense. You know, I definitely see a conflict there, but I'm curious to see like how far it goes. Because the thing is that having Roman Reigns as the tribal chief, I don't know how that's going to work as a babyface. And then like if Roman Reigns doesn't have Paul Heyman, I don't know how that entire character would work.
He doesn't need Paul anymore, but he's also stated the day that, you know, he no longer, you know, has Paul Heyman, he's no longer the tribal chief. Right? Like he knows that he can't stay behind Paul Heyman forever. But he also understands that his character is going to have to elevate, is going to have to evolve. So it's where else do you go from being a tribal chief? Like what is the next?
I mean the high chief, and that's what The Rock is, right? So now The Rock is actually a high chief, right? And so was his grandfather. So now, you know, how much into reality do they break that into? You know what I mean? Because Roman Reigns is the chief of a tribe, but not like the chief of, you know, it's kind of like a state senator and a governor type of thing. You know what I mean? Like you run a region, but not the whole tribe, if that makes sense. And that's probably what it's going to be. It might be another thing because, like the Tongas, they're from like a totally different island. So it might be something like that, you know, who knows where it's going to go. But one thing I did find interesting was the whole I love yous, I love yous, I love yous, right? Because that happened when the first conflict happened, like a couple years ago when Roman became champion, right? And then when Roman was fighting when he was fighting Jay, beating him up and telling him how much he loves him, how much he loves him, how much he loves him, and all of that. And I feel like here, that whole thing was repeated with the whole thing with that, pretty much kind of like cementing Solo as the tribal chief. And then even later on when they were saying things by orders of the tribal chief. I think that Solo is, I guess, the new tribal chief, but now they're breaking that down slowly because they're not necessarily saying that, you know? They're just showing how scared Paul Heyman is. You know, he was always just as scared of Roman Reigns that way. So he's pretty much treating him that like that. But Solo's definitely getting a major push. Now I understand. I definitely understand why he beat John Cena at SummerSlam.
The second coming of Umaga, he embodies that 100%. So kudos to him, but more so getting into this, I seen somebody put it in there. Jeffrey said this was the hug of death, right? And then we get a little reveal. I'm just gonna, cause I don't want to get copyrighted. We see who it is, right?
Mm-hmm.
Tomatonga, the son of Haku, nephew of what's the other one? Ming. So, and this is actually, me and Mike were having a little spat back and forth, and he goes, no pop, right? I beg to differ because the minute the hood comes off, crowd goes eight for a split second, right? Because you realize, hey, that's another person in the bloodline, right? Like, even if you don't know who he is, some people know who he is. You know, if you've been watching New Japan Pro Wrestling for the past 10 years, if you're an internet wrestling community specialist, you know who he is, right? For most people that don't know, you're probably just going off the fact that, hey, he kind of looks like them. Like, he looks like a Jimmy Solo Roman. He is a light skin. He looks Samoan. That's another bloodline member. Boom, pop. But then it gets a little uncomfortable, right? It gets a little uncomfortable with the pop because they then completely decimate Jimmy. Poor Jimmy.
Poor Jimmy. Yeah. Well, poor Jimmy. That was coming. That was coming. Poor like, Jimmy. Everybody saw that coming.
I mean, true, but
eventually that was gonna happen, like, because Jimmy's the one that did the kick. Jimmy's the cause of Jay leaving. You know true. What I mean? Jimmy is true. The one who kicked Roman, and then ever since then, Roman, he was always just trying to get in Roman's good graces. Didn't you notice every time he put his hand out for a dap, it was always left hanging? You know what I mean?
He's left hanging with everybody because he's a joke. That's the problem. He doesn't take anything seriously, and that's the problem with that, right? But
I mean, he does it now. When he was a champion, he did. You know, he wasn't this clowny when he was a champion. I mean, don't get me wrong. I like it. I like the whole
thing. He's failed them so many times, though. He's failed them in getting Jay to come back to the bloodline. He's failed them.
See, now, I thought Jay was going to pop up last night. That's what I thought was going to happen.
Raw guy, so why would he be there at SmackDown? So
yeah.
I don't expect them talent-wise to be in the same building until 2 weeks. 2 weeks from now. No, actually, it'll be next week.
I'm sorry, y'all in the chat. Refresh my memory. When did they say the draft is? Is it the 26th or is it the 22nd of this month?
So that's probably the next time we'll see talent under the same roof.
Probably. I mean, like, honestly, a lot of this stuff that they might be doing right now might end up just being filler for a couple of key matches, because, like, they're about to go to France, and, you know, it's just like, it's going to be just like Puerto Rico last year, where, you know, where you have this big crowd of people that see WWE maybe once or twice a year. You know, and now they're going to get a PLE, and it's going to be a big thing. The crowd is going to be crazy. So they're going to cater to the crowd somehow. I think whatever it is that they do, they cater to this crowd. Now, I wouldn't be surprised if Roman Reigns doesn't show up, but I wouldn't be surprised either if he does, because if they do some kind of grudge match for Backlash, then it'll be really good for the crowd
I hear you now.
All my technology is dead today.
The little tidbit that we see, right, is we get the Paul, the infamous call Roman Reigns, right? And except for this time, we didn't get, you know, call Roman Reigns, because Solo snatches the phone, throws it down, yep, steps on it. And Paul Heyman is literally forced to be Solo's bitch at this point in time. So we get a backstage segment after this where Kayla's trying to get, you know, word on Jimmy. And you can tell Paul is not with any of this. Tama comes up to him, orders of the tribal chief, right? And then Solo comes right behind him. This is signature Solo, right? He doesn't need to say anything but look at his thumb, and he means mm-hmm. business. And Paul knows that he means business because look at his face here, right? So I think that this was good. And then at the end of it, when Solo walks away, Paul goes in the most frightened voice, he goes, "What the hell is going on here?"
That's right. Paul is such an actor. I absolutely love it, right? Because he's making all of this believable. He's making all of this believable. I'm loving this story. Like, when it's all said and done, I already think that the Bloodline has the greatest story in professional wrestling, and because it's been able to capture us for 4 years, right? Yeah. And Vinny, shout out to Vinny for AEW Dynamite Review Show, sometimes fills in on Raw. He tends to think that is the NWO. And the problem with that is NWO had a good run for a better part of 18 to 24 months, but then it wasn't strong anymore. And you got another year out of it by splitting up Wolfpack and Hollywood, but that maybe lasted 8 months. But it didn't intrigue you. It was just guerrilla warfare, which is fine. It was fine at that point in time, because everybody had a group. Which I love. Raven's Flock. You got Hollywood Hogan. You got Wolfpack. You got Four Horsemen. You got the LWO. You had a lot of warfare then, but it weren't telling a story with it. And with the Bloodline, you're telling the story. And what is the greatest story that we know? It's all about family. It's all about family. Everybody can relate to the story of family one way or another. You got the too good to be around family. You got the backstabbing family. You got the egotistical family. You got the family that cares too much and it comes back to bite you in the ass. So there's all types of aspects of family that we can get down with. But I was saying that, this is the greatest storyline because of things like this with Paul Heyman and the way that he reacts, right? And the fact of the matter is for 4 years, we have been talking about this on, SmackDown review shows, Monday Night Raw review show. Like, it's a big bulk of our conversation and nothing has happened as far as a match. Like, this is just a segment that lasted, combined segment that maybe from the first time they walked to Cody's locker room to their in ring to this part, you probably had about 8 minutes and nothing physical outside of Jimmy getting attacked, but it's more so looking at the mannerisms and things of that nature. Your thoughts on this ending segment of the Bloodline's night?
Well, I think it's a little bit of foreshadowing more than anything else. I think it's bringing the audience into what's going on as far as the Bloodline goes. One thing you were alluding to is it's one of the hottest storylines in years, and this is just a continuance of it. Like we said before, Roman doesn't need the title in order for this stuff to continue going on. Because right now, the big question mark is what's next for Roman Reigns, especially after he did that post on the treadmill.
Mm-hmm.
Where apparently it's now day two. There's a continuance to this. So that's what we're happy about. But the other question is Cody Rhodes gonna get the same kind of run? Is he gonna be around for 3 years with the belt? And
Absolutely. Who knows?
And what really is next for him since Darth Vader's been defeated? You know what I mean? So, what's next for Luke Skywalker now? Like, since Darth Vader's been defeated and, the Big Bad Wolf is gone, who's going to be the next Big Bad Wolf? And so, this thing right here, especially with the way that Paul Heyman was reacting, it was, because he's all like, what the hell? What is this? What is, because he's losing control of the situation.
That's crazy because we've been on for 30 minutes, right? We took a big chunk of the show just by Bloodline. This is what I'm talking about. Just by Bloodline, we've taken a big chunk of the show. But we're going to take our first and only break. So it's going to be a little lengthy. We're going to give you two commercials back-to-back, AEW and the Mike Knox Show. Y'all stay tuned. This is SmackDown Penitentiary.
I agree. I think Well, Becky did have strep throat. We gotta give her credit. She worked with strep throat.
Who?
102 temperature. Mama's gotta get the work done.
Well, listen, I'm gonna tell you this. Mama whooped that ass all over the ring. I tell you what, that ass was working hard, fat ass at the best. I'm gonna tell you what, that's probably the best looking ass of all WWE. Hold on.
You're muted.
My numbers, okay?
Oh,
I'm gonna give you my numbers because I'm gonna tell you what, Mama let that fat ass down. I'm gonna give you
Vince, one
is gonna be 8.5. Night two is probably gonna be a 6.5.
Yeah, we're not Vince. You need to relax when you say things like that. No, we can't do that.
Come on!
No, we did it all on
Raw Review. Go back and watch a Raw WrestleMania. We talked about her ass all night.
Vince, stop. Go on, Cactus Katie.
Becky was pulling everything out to try to get Rhea out of there, and Rhea was just taking it and giving her more.
Take that.
But I will say that I think the right person won. Oh my Lance. Listen, I've never in my life been so enamored with Gothic in my life. The only other person was a homegirl from The Craft.
Really?
The one that was in
the one about the chick from the Water Boy?
Yeah.
You are weird.
I'm telling you, man. Listen, I'm telling you. And Rose McGowan give me goth vibes. She could put a whole jawbreaker in her mouth. Like, come on. Like, I feel like Rhea could do the same thing. But you said there was no pop.
That was just comparing to show Dan that we really do appreciate the asses in wrestling. And for you to review AEW Dynamite and not talk about the asses they have there. Talk about Toni Storm's thick ass. Anna James, who I think has the most beautiful ass on the AEW roster. Queen Aminata's ass. And you get offended? We talking about mommy's ass? Oh, come on over to the SmackDown Penitentiary and the Mike Knox Show. We'll talk some ass for you. We'll talk some ass all day. Now, we're going to get into this, the action of SmackDown. The Sky Blue. Yes, thank you. Sky Blue, that little, my gosh. But this is a SmackDown Penitentiary. We don't give AEW too much shine. Not like they give us shine every week because they talk about us for 45 minutes. We don't do that in there. Y'all get y'all a little minute and that's it. Now, going on to the action. Now, let's get into the action of the night. Now, this is funny to me, right? And we get our first triple threat match. When they put this graphic up, first of all, they put this dumbass graphic. Look how Bobby Lashley's smiling. I knew his goofy ass was going to fucking lose. But
you got him looking like a jobber.
He looks stupid. Hey, get the earring out. Like, I don't know what they get. He doesn't look like the Almighty. And I will say this. This is my gripe about this form of Bobby Lashley that we have. And it's not just the fact that they still won't call this group powerful and pride, or pride and powerful, or whatever they do, but they do have some dope hoodies that are still not on WWEshop.com, so they must have went out of their way and paid for it in their own pocket to get this created. Maybe some copyright things going on in the back. They probably haven't gotten it fully trademarked yet, so they can't officially be called that, right? But my biggest gripe. Yes, George, this is what they're calling them, but they're not calling them that on TV yet. They haven't said anything about the name yet. That's why it's Bobby Lashley and the Street Profits. But on screen, you can see their shirts have all four members, right? And it says Pride and Powerful on it with them raising their fists in the air. So it's just hasn't been called that. And that's, which is weird because I don't know. Maybe it's like Degeneration X when they weren't really DX, and then Bret Hart kind of alluded to them being degenerates, and lo and behold, they took this shit right there.
That sounds a lot like what LAX used to be.
Yes.
When they first started in AEW.
Because it sounds like they didn't want to be, well, LAX was still Pride and Powerful. Yes.
Yeah.
Pride and Powerful. Yeah, they couldn't be LAX because that was a TNA thing. So they Proud and Powerful.
Yeah, because I remember when I met them.
Pride and Powerful. Yes.
That's what they were billed as.
Yeah.
Like Proud and Powerful, something like that.
My gripe with Bobby Lashley's character under this regime of Triple H, he doesn't feel like he's almighty anymore. Mm. Now, when it was Vince McMahon still part of the creative, we got Bobby Lashley coming out to his mini stage. We got the spotlight on him. We got the 3D gold smoke with the lightning with him just like this until his music actually, he got an intro before the intro of his music. And with this Triple H thing, he just doesn't get it. He's not treated like the almighty. He's not treated like, you know, he was when he had Leo Rush hyping him. He wasn't treated like he was when he had MVP as his mouthpiece. He wasn't treated like he was when he was a big deal. That might just be a personal gripe, but that little subtle change in how he doesn't get the same pyro. And sometimes he gets pyro, sometimes he doesn't, right? Like, He got just the two lightning flashes, but I get it. It's too much like The Rock now. Rock took over, so the final boss has the lightning entrance. But
I don't know, man. He's giving me more manager vibes than anything else. I mean, yeah, he's still in matches, but I don't know. I feel like this is going somewhere. Especially they're following his music with the dun dun dun, like all of them doing that now. I really don't know where they're taking this, but yeah, I don't know if he's being a nice guy now so that then he can get mean and then the whole group gets mean. Like, yeah. I don't know, but the thing about it is just that they've definitely been pushing this group for a while, and there is a certain outcome that they're after. I still don't know what that outcome is, but they definitely doing that. And like, you know, everybody's been saying that MVP needs to be in this group. MVP and Omos need to be in this group. And I don't know if it's just like a slow thing. And then the other thing is that all of the stuff going around about how the Hurt Business reunited at Wale Mania. Who knows? You know, that may be a thing. You know what I mean? Because with wrestling, I especially now, because of the internet, I think that the companies, like, they like to play with the fan base and put little things out there so that then people could just start thinking wild things. You know what I mean? Yeah, you know, I mean, and I got that thought process from the CM Punk interview, because he's just like, all right, believe the bullshit, it makes me money. You know, and if that's the thought process a lot of wrestlers have, then yeah. Yeah, so, you know, I really think that they're going to, you know, they're doing something. They're just letting everybody think whatever they want to think. But they're definitely doing something.
Yeah, so going to this match, and I'm looking at this, when I'm looking at this graphic, right, it can't be Bobby right now. Because if we're going to be truthful, Bobby Lashley in any facade of whatever character should shatter the shit out of Cody Rhodes, right? Easily. You can't feed the almighty to Cody Rhodes in his first title defense. It's just not believable. I don't care how many crossroads he hits on Lashley, but sometimes they do make Lashley look really stupid. But Lashley's been on a roll. He was hot coming off of WrestleMania. LA was hot coming off of Mania. Santos, not so much, but his character keeps evolving, and that's what they need. So looking at the match was actually, it started off a little sloppy, but that's a credit to them not having, you know, the ring chemistry and not being familiar with being in a ring with one another, which is fine. We see that Legado del Fantasma tries to interfere, and then Prophets come out there, and just as Dawkins is about to go flying, we see what's the gosh, I forget her name every time. Perez? No, what is her name? Somebody help me out in the chat. What's Legado del Fantasma's leading lady?
Isn't that Electra Lopez?
Electra Lopez, yes. Thank you. I know it was as something. She stops him. And then B-Fab is getting better with this goddamn bicycle, big boot, whatever it is. She's getting some length in that shit. Like, she snuffed Scarlett out at Mania with that shit, right? And then she got Electra Lopez with it, too. And the crowd... I've never seen the crowd pop so hard for B-Fab just doing this bicycle kick. I've never seen it before, right? But all she does is get that one move off and the crowd goes ape shit, right? And DMG, listen, and this is what I'm saying. Listen, the one move that she can do, right? And the crowd goes ape shit for it. I am here for it. That's cool. As long as she doesn't try to do too much, I'm loving it. And I think that's the key to it, right? So we get the brawl between them, and just as Lashley is about to finish the match off, so to speak, goes for the spear. It gets sidestepped. He hits the turnbuckle. He's out, and LA Knight capitalizes, hits Santos Escobar, gets the win. I think just looking at this graphic in itself, you can tell who was going to take the fall for this one, and it even if it was going to be Bobby that won, Santos was still going to take that fall. You can't stunt the growth of Lashley's popularity or LA Knight's popularity coming off of WrestleMania. Your thoughts on the match that we had and the inclusion of both of those factions?
I mean, I think it was just really more to generate heat and get a bunch of yes. To generate heat for Legado, to probably start a little feud between the Street Profits and them. They're probably gonna try to fight over the tag team championships, you know, so like, yeah, they might have like a little tournament for the tag team championships and they might end up doing that. But as far as that goes, you know, you could tell that it was gonna be LA Knight to win that match and, you know, all the years and all of that. Like, you could tell that that's where they were gonna go with that. Like, that was pretty predictable, honestly. As far as the outcome of the match. But yeah, that whole thing was, it was cool because it, you know, they're giving everybody the shine, especially B-Fab.
With that damn kick. So we then get we see Bayley walking backstage. And first and foremost, I just want to say before I start my soliloquy about Bayley, is anybody that knows me, when I have to start something involving Bayley, you guys can chime in the chat with me as I mellow my voice out and set the tone. Bayley, first and foremost, let's acknowledge this bodysuit. She had a bodysuit on as she was walking into the arena. It was all black bodysuit. I said, she can't wear that on TV. There's no way. She then proceeds to jump into a blue bodysuit. Jesus golly. So for those of you in the chat, you can say it with me. I love you, Pamela Martinez. Jesus golly. Manigly. She was looking fuego. Fuego, fuego, fuego. Fire, fire. The crowd pops crazy for Bayley. And she goes into, you know, just going in and thanking the fans. In my house, some of them, they forgot how she trashed them so much for so many months, right? But that's the thing about professional wrestling. You know, so many heel turns. The suit was definitely suited. So many heel turns, and it doesn't. It does exactly, George. Yes, we love you, Pamela Martinez. You can turn heel, turn face, turn heel, turn face 80 times. I mean, hell, it got to the point where Big Show, he couldn't turn anymore because they got tired of it. He couldn't turn anymore. We get Bayley talking, and then we get
Tiffy time.
We get Tiffy time coming out there doing what Tiffy time does. The center of the universe says that it was offensive. Listen, the cameraman, he called a slight toe. But you listen, this is the one thing I would say. AEW cameramen, they know somebody's in their ear backstage telling them get all the ass, get all the toe, get all the tit meat, all of it, right? Get it all. But you know, WWE will give you, you can't blink. You blink, you missed it. And it's for some people that's what happened, right? And Bayley, Tiffy time interrupts Bayley, and she is telling her that she thinks that she's given an open challenge, and you know, she'll accept the challenge, but the challenge is, you know, it really wasn't a challenge. It was more so hey, I'm going to give this to a Naomi, and Naomi comes out there, and they're both like high five, and then they get this like dap up, right? Like, what is that? Give me some. Like, give me this dap up. Like, what's up? And Tiffy is like, I already beat you. Like, so what are you doing? I already beat you, Naomi. What are you doing? And listen, Tiffy definitely looking good. She gotta get a little bit more booty meat for me. She gotta get some squats. She gotta do some squat work. But listen, when Tiffy came out there, I said there's no way she can wrestle in that top. There's no way she can wrestle in that top. Them things was about to poke out, right? Mm-hmm. So Naomi tells her, she said, you done tried to be on the wrong day, little girl. Right? The fact that Naomi is now referring to new talent as little girl shows her age. And she's only 36, which is old, but it's still relatively young. Right, it's all business wise, but for most people, they're hitting their prime of their career in their mid 30s. Your thoughts?
Let's not forget, Naomi's a Funkadactyl. You know how long that was? Yeah. How long ago that was? She's been there since she was 19.
Yeah, yeah.
So it doesn't matter how young she is, she deserves that veteran status. She's like Paige, you know what I mean? Paige is still in her 20s, but yeah, she pretty much got that veteran status.
I will say that this match was better than the first match that I had seen between them two.
Yeah.
Right? And
yeah,
a lot of good spots. Tiffy, this was their first one, right? It was very sloppy, but that was due to them not being familiar. Tiffy not being, I think this might have been like one of her first televised matches on SmackDown.
Yeah, right? I think so.
And she wasn't that impressive, but she tried to make sure that she did give her the rub, which is absolutely fine. She gave her the rub, nice rub, right? But this other match that they just did was definitely her getting to wrestle now. Like she's now, forget the rub, let's wrestle.
Yeah, I mean, she just returned the rub.
Yeah, yep. And that's the it was a much better match, much better spots for both ladies, mm-hmm, right? And I will say this. Naomi still, she still gets winded, but she's doing better with her moves, and the timing of them. But I think that her and Tiffy were good partners tonight, as far as everything else goes. But Bayley's looking, trying to see who's going to be her number one contender, and it ends up Tiffy tries to. Well, first of all, the Alabama slam that Tiffy hit on Naomi, boy, she put some torque on that thing. Listen, it was a lot of cake. The cake was caking in the ring with Naomi and Bayley. The cake was, what the hell is that? Oh, my PlayStation just turned off. The cake was cake.
Which one do you want?
Does anybody PS5 just randomly talks for no reason? Like, what the hell was that?
Oh,
Yeah, a lot of stake in that ring. A lot of stake in that ring. So Naomi gets the dub, and we get Naomi versus Bayley for the women's championship. This is how you elevate this title more than what Rhea has over there on Raw, because for Rhea's reign, she didn't really defend it very much. You need title defenses against meaningful opponents, and I would say, what better way to start her runoff than to face Naomi? Your thoughts on this match and Naomi versus Bayley?
I find it strange that they're doing a baby right away. I think it's strange that they're doing that, but then at the same time, Naomi is probably one of the most recognized characters in WWE, so for her to go to France probably makes sense, especially now, since Bayley doesn't really have a feud or a problem or an issue, and
right.
I don't think they're gonna turn Naomi heel, because I don't think she can do heel, to be honest with you. I don't think it's just in her personality to do heel. Yeah, I think it's definitely him. And this is, in my opinion, this whole thing is going to go down like Daniel Bryan versus John Cena type of thing, where like they'll put on a quality match and then Bayley will win.
I will say that I think it's okay to do face and face, right? But I did catch the little hint on commentary that was said that, Naomi's too nice. She doesn't have a mean streak, right? This is what commentary, said. So I think that it maybe that foreshadowing in that sense is going to be something that that they, maybe everybody's right. Naomi is too nice. She loses because she's too nice. She doesn't have that mean streak. And maybe she could sort of get a tweak of character. But said, shout out to you. I'm glad that you put this comment here, because this is where I was going. For next week, I could probably see Damage Control ruining this. Thank you, G. I couldn't remember who the hell said it, and I keep forgetting the actual teams. Graves is on Raw, correct? I keep forgetting. I thought it was Graves. Most of the losers in big matches over Mania didn't show up for their respective brands this week. I don't think that Naomi will beat Bayley. I think that it's due to there going to be a story change, a character change, story arc for Naomi. But I also think that Damage Control will show some, they can take a week off and then come back. And I think that, team bad, that was horrible. I'm sorry. It was horrible heel work from all of those.
But look, who was the person who did the most talking in Team Bad? Sasha Banks.
It wasn't very good.
Naomi was like Solo Sikoa. She was standing.
No, that's more Tamina. Tamina was more so, because Tamina can't talk for shit.
Both of them did, because Sasha Banks is the one with the mice. Because okay, it was more like Toxic Attraction, where Mandy Rose was the only one talking type shit. That's pretty much what that faction was like. They put her in a bad group, but then she never said any bad things.
Ding, 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 ding. George, thank you for showing King Kota some love. Love it. I love it. I love it. Love it when we can get King Kota some love. Definitely down with King Kota.
If Dakota Kai does that, then it should be a SummerSlam.
All right, let's move on.
That's funny because if Naomi was her husband, then she would have mic skills.
She would have, like, how is that your husband? You should be able to beat shredded motherfuckers like a goddamn a rap battle, but you can't.
Now we're getting to what everybody has been clamoring for, right? Everybody's been wanting these two beautiful black Amazonian specimen of women's. Get you a women's. And Jade and Bianca Belair versus Chelsea Green and Piper Niven. And Chelsea can't get the hell away from Jade because she goes on SmackDown to complain about Adam Pearce putting her against Jade. And then she goes, you wouldn't do that to me, right, Adam Pearce? You wouldn't put me. And he goes, no. Your match is next. And her and Piper come out and she's ready. And then all of a sudden the lights get low and it's Jade again.
I'm not gonna lie. Chelsea Green plays such a good Karen.
I love
it. It's not even funny.
She's so necessary. She's so necessary. And this is the issue that, you know, I have sometimes when we're debating with people across the UPR network, is that not everybody can be a star, but everybody can still shine, right? Like, you don't need a belt to be a star. There's some really dope mid-carders that we grew up watching in the late 90s, early 2000s, the Attitude Era. There were some great ones. Like Piper, and he's still a big deal. He still was a really big deal. And anytime you can get your mid-carders to get you money and TV time and ticket sales and merchandise, it's always a good thing. And Chelsea, she knows how to work. She's a good worker, and they trust her clearly. They can give her the R-Truth role, and she can just run away with it. And I think that she thrives in it. I think that Chelsea will be taken much more seriously when my baby comes back, Daddy DeVille. When Daddy DeVille comes back, we'll get a more serious Chelsea again, because I think that they were onto something with them. But getting back in these comments before we continue on with this match, listen, I'm very surprised Executive Consultant has not popped up. He was here before the show started, but you know, if he comes, I'm going to be promoting that t-shirt. So y'all better, you know, make sure y'all get them $14.99, Executive Contradiction. I think that Bianca and Jade being tag champs is going to set the tag team, the women's tag division, it's going to reset it.
No.
I
don't think they should.
Women are going to be reminiscent of Nia Jax and Shayna Baszler. That run that they had was crazy. And shout out to Mike Knox, because he always said the only thing that's going to stop Shayna and Nia from lose, like the only thing that's going to make them lose the belt is themselves, right? And that's the only way that you can make it believable that anybody can beat them, because they were shattering everybody. They were shattering everybody. So I think that they will be tag champs, and that's a good story to go to, but you need to elevate the rest of that women's division as far as tag teams go, because they will just, I mean, if you talk about Roman Reigns' record, they will have a record longer than, I think, who's the longest? Was it Bayley and Sasha, or is it Nia and Shayna? Either way, they'll have a reign bigger than both of those reigns, and then it'll become a situation where there's nobody left. So
personally, I think they should go a different route with that. I think they should do Naomi and Bianca as tag team champions. Why do I say that? Number one, Naomi is the first black tag team champion, right? But that reign ended in controversy. So putting that belt back on her, especially with Bianca Belair, makes sense. Number two, there's already, Bianca Belair has a beef with Bayley. And Bayley has a beef with Damage Control. Damage Control have the belts. It all fits into each other's story, you know. And then putting the belt on Naomi again, And then, mind you, if Naomi has the belt when she's going to go face Bayley, that would be interesting as well. But as far as Jade Cargill goes, I think, in my opinion, I think they should throw her at Nia Jax and do a program with Nia Jax so that then we could see more of her as a singles competitor, unless it's necessary to put her in a tag team. But I think this is really good.
I think this is really good where they got her at right now. You got somebody in the company for the past, you know, 4 years in Bianca Belair, who has been the constant professional for the women's division. She's probably the fastest rising woman in history for them, main eventing, you know, and the fact that they put somebody with, you know, in her with a Jade Cargill, I think that means that the company trusts Bianca. And they've said in their press conference after Mania that they actually relate to each other, even though they're so different, and that Naomi and Bianca has been kind of taking Jade under their wing to show her the ropes of what she needs. So I think that if you continue to put her and Bianca in the light of, you know, then they can break off, and then we can get the matchups that we want: Bianca and Jade, Jade and Nia, Jade and Raquel Rodriguez, you know, Jade and Mommy. Like, there's a lot that you can do with Jade, and there's literally a laundry list of women, but it has to be in there. And all of those women I just named are absolute constant professionals, and they know how to put people over. I would kind of say maybe, to a lesser degree, Raquel, only because she's dealing with her problems and she's not been able to get a lot of runs in. But I want to focus on these two comments here because we are talking about the women's tag team. Run DMG saying that all the tag team wrestling fell off. I tend to disagree based off of what we saw at Mania from those gentlemen that were in the six-pack ladder match challenge. But this list, right? Kaden and Katana, Unholy Union, Piper and Chelsea, Kabuki Warriors, Zoe and Shayna, Indy and Candice. I think that's a good, I think that's a respectable women's tag division right now. I still think that overall, the best as a team is still Kaden and Katana because they are an actual team and they've been together for years, right? The second would be the Kabuki Warriors, because they've been together for years as well. Mm-hmm. So I would do 1A, 1B for those two. And then everybody else just needs to keep building and building. I think Zoe and Shayna could be very dangerous because they're super hard hitting as a tag team. So I think their tag division is really, really in a good spot. You know what, Seth? I don't understand why people are mad either. This is how you build up an attraction. This is how you build up a monster. We never complained back in the day when Goldberg was beating people so easy. So I don't understand why now.
But that's great. That's great. That's the thing. I think that they should build her character more like that, as far as her doing a bunch of squash matches, fucking people up, then somebody coming out there and trying her. And all of that, you know what I mean? Because she's not really feuding with anybody. She's mm-hmm. friends with people, but she's not feuding with anybody. And I think that if you start a little thing with her, it'll be fine. And then if she needs help, Bianca and Naomi will come out. Because, you know, the thing is, I personally would like to see a tag team championship on Bianca Belair. She already had both major titles. You know, if they do the same thing that they do on NXT and put a mid-card title inside of the main roster, that would be great. But personally, I don't think Jade Cargill needs other people right now. I mean, it's good to have friends, but I don't think that she needs them. I think that she needs to be the main showcase by herself.
I would say... I want to combat you on this, but I'm not going to combat you. But I will just say there was a lot of people that thought that Nia did not belong in the ring with Charlotte. So we may get a surprise, right? Like a specimen, an attraction like Jade, you're going with an attraction. You're going with the attraction versus the actual constant professional wrestler. I don't think that I don't think that that's a bad, that's not a bad move in any sense of it. So I would say I agree, but I disagree. Goldberg doesn't deserve a good dog damn thing anymore, the way he is shitting on WWE because he didn't get what he wanted. So he don't deserve nothing. He got more than what he should have got. And then the disrespect Asuka for breaking his record and then try to say that he doesn't know who Asuka's name is. And then somebody called him out and found his tweet where he fucking congratulated her. Like, so he's giving big Ryback vibes. Like, we ain't got no time for that. But shout out to me because Trash. I did
he's
predict.
Definitely he's giving Ryback vibes.
Yeah, yeah. Like. Shout out to me for I said that there's going to be a women's mid-card title. However, the wrong damn brand. It's NXT, but still, I said it was coming. But I thought it was going to be main roster. Bianca versus Rhea for SummerSlam or next year's Mania. Mania is the only thing that we need this match for. Mania is the only. I mean, if you want to do you know, a Cody and Seth type thing where it's best of three, but, you know, Cody washed the shit out of Seth, so I can never take Seth seriously versus Cody. And even if he does eventually beat Cody, why would we care? Because he got washed three times. So I don't think that this is a thing. I think that the reason why Roman lost is because had he not, who knows the backlash that WrestleMania would have had. And I agree with a lot of people saying that, you know, I was of the person that, you know, me and Vic did say that he should beat Hulk Hogan. We had that debate.
He did beat Hulk Hogan. He beat Hulk Hogan by having the most main events.
Yeah.
Ever,
yeah,
at WrestleMania.
You know the record I'm talking about.
That WrestleMania has two nights. Each night counted. That was very crazy. Smart. I know that was Triple H that did that. That was brilliant because he gave the crowd what he wanted. What did he do? He beat Hulk Hogan. How did he beat him? Got the most main events. That's hard to get. That's hard to do. That's harder to do than have a lot of days.
I would be absolutely livid if I had to lose to Cody over and over and over. But back to this match, because y'all just took me to a whole new, y'all took me to a whole nother direction. But shout out to y'all, because this is why we are the fastest rising show on UPR, because of people like y'all to chat. Now, into this match, quick, powerful showing. Look at Jade. Oh, look at Jade. Mm-hmm. Oh, stop. All right. Ooh, there we go.
That woman, y'all. What more can you say about these women? Like, Lord,
they are, I cannot help. But looking at this image, I cannot help but to think of people like my man Mike Knox, who has a lovely daughter who looks at this and believes and her goals and aspirations, right? And we had the debate on the post media show, and to these type of situations, I love this, right? As a black wrestling fan, I didn't feel like it was shoved. I didn't feel like, you know, it was forced. This seems very natural, and it's not black people be put together because they're black people, because we hear them speak together, they're clearly different mindsets that are in a sense very alike. And I think that is what draws you to them, right? It's the fact of them separately and you getting to know them, not in the ring, but like their interviews, their backstage stuff, and then put them in the ring together. I think that seems very more natural, but I get it. Not everybody looks at wrestling in that perspective, but this is a very beautiful look for both ladies,
mm-hmm,
women around, and that tag division. Your thoughts on this match?
I mean, was a squash match. It was just to make her look good. You know what I mean? That's all it was for. Like, that's the main thing. They're presenting her as a singles competitor. And that's why I keep saying, like, she needs to just continue as a singles competitor. And I hope that she gets, personally, I hope that she gets like a little bit of an undefeated streak for a little while, and then they put the shine on her, or maybe like put her in the ring with Tiffany Stratton, because they're the new shiny things. You know what I mean? Bianca Belair, you know, even though she hasn't been around that many years, she's pretty much a veteran at this point. You know what I mean? That's why I'm so gung-ho about her going with Naomi. Bianca Belair doesn't need the rub. Bianca Belair doesn't need, you know, already has the shine. Bianca Belair, for the past maybe 3 years, has been every little black girl's, like, aspiration when it used to be Sasha Banks. You know what I mean? Sasha Banks was pretty much, you know, when she lost to Bianca Belair, pretty much passed that torch. You feel me? So, it could be Jade. But I personally think that Jade should definitely get more shine by herself. Show that she has friends, but give her shine by herself. I would much prefer to see Naomi and Bianca Belair take those tag team championships. Because the other thing with that is that you can see that their friendship clearly is longer, and clearly, you know, they're closer, you know. And then the other thing is that you can also get Bayley involved in that situation, because Bayley and Bianca is still kind of bumping heads, you know, and Naomi is the peacemaker with that, you know. So if Bayley helps them get the championships, then, you know, Bayley becomes part of the group of friends, and then everybody's friends, and then Jade Cargill could do something later.
So I wanted to do this purposely and go and talk about more of the action than the segments beforehand, because some of the segments were outside of Bloodline and stuff like that. It didn't really matter, right? Bloodline ruled, and they were only on for 10 minutes total. We got a promo from A-Town Down Under, and they're actually acknowledging them finally as A-Town Down Under, in which, you know, they were only doing it on commentary. Now they've got a whole promo, and it's what you would expect for them. Cocky, haha, we won, you guys suck. And then the camera pans out, and we get New Catch Republic, Nick Aldis, and Street Profits. I am okay with this. I have been on the train. I love New Catch Republic. I love what they've been doing with them. Every week they've gotten better and better. They're taken seriously as a tag team. And we all know the Street Profits, how the Street Profits at this point in time should be treated like the New Day, like the Usos, right?
Facts.
Like, they should be treated like them. And whereas they're the most veteran team on SmackDown at this point in time, and they should be treated with much more than getting jobbed out to AOP. So,
I mean, look, in my opinion, I really think that Vince looks at Bianca Belair as the female John Cena, and as Montez Ford as another Big E. Montez Ford has amazing mic skills. Montez Ford can sell anything. You put Montez Ford to sell something for WWE Shop, it's getting sold.
Yep.
You know what I mean? And they got their own TV show for all of that. And, like, I hate to say this, but I feel like they look at Montez Ford more than anything as a promoter.
And that's fine. I mean, look how long Titus O'Neil has been in WWE, and he's got one of the worst records, the worst gimmicks. Has some of the most matches, has some of the worst matches, has some of the best bloopers, right? But they still keep him around. R-Truth, still keep him around for comedic relief, right? But he's also a good media person.
Wait a minute. How many times did Titus O'Neil go in that ring and really get you to respond off of some shit that he did? Montez Ford is doing all kinds of jumps and flips and all kinds of shit that makes you go, whoa.
Yeah.
Like, Montez Ford is a future champion. Everybody sees that. Yeah. Out of that entire group, Montez Ford is the most talented. Everybody knows that. You know, so I think that now that Triple H is running the show, he's definitely the Street Profits are going to get their NXT push, because when they were in NXT, they, you know what I mean, they had major matches and the War Raiders, and you know, they had cups falling from the ceiling, they had all kinds of stuff, because Triple H really knows what's up with these guys, you know what I mean. When Vince was running things, I think that he was just, you know, using them and not really pushing them. And now I think all of that is going to change. I really do.
The primetime players
was As far as this goes, yeah, they were like prime time, straight up, just like prime time. That money. Yeah.
Primetime players, if anybody in the chat can indulge me, did primetime players ever win the tag championships? I know Crime Time did not, which that is
a they didn't.
Shame.
Prime time players, I think they did. I don't know.
I feel like they did, but
I want to say they didn't. Can somebody get that fact for us?
I'm curious now. See if they won that.
Moving on to the show, we get, okay, they did win. I did not recognize that they did win. I want to say that we got something from Logan Paul. Just, it was one of the weaker segments from Logan Paul, pre-recorded weaker segments. Just him being him, bragging about, you know, what he's done on social media and yada yada yada. Good for him, but I would expect more for the SmackDown after Mania, right? Which is fine though. But after that, we get a promo from AJ Styles. Before I go into that, did you catch that little tidbit in the Bianca and Jay tag match? At the bottom right of the screen, there was like a glitch. And a lot of people are saying it's Uncle Howdy references. They're doing them before Raw and SmackDown. They're doing them after Raw and SmackDown. They're doing little things before and after. And then in the middle, we're getting a flash of graphic. Did you catch that?
Yeah.
So yeah,
a lot of people are saying how that's, you know, they're going to bring back the Uncle Howdy thing. I got mixed feelings about that, because at the time it was part of Bray Wyatt's character. It was a little bit demonic and things like that. But if they bring it back now, it's kind of like, I don't know, it feels like going to Bray Wyatt's funeral, for lack of a better phrase. It feels like watching the documentary, or like, you know, just say keeping the focus on Bray Wyatt and the fact that he passed away. I hope I'm wrong about that, depending on what creative they use or whatever, right? But you know, I feel like it's one of those things. Like, in my opinion, I think Bo Dallas should just be Bo Dallas and have cheaper. You know what I mean?
I absolutely agree, because I am not of the ilk of watching the documentary, and I've watched this documentary 2.5 times. It's one of my favorite WWE documentaries, right next to the Becoming Cody Rhodes American Nightmare. That's a really good documentary. But this one, it's probably one of the most emotional documentaries I've had the pleasure of watching. And Bo Dallas, who's had a respectable mid-card career, right? He's had a respectable mid-card career. If he comes back and he's Bo Wyatt, I'll be cool with it. I wouldn't care, but I don't need you full time as Uncle Howdy. I don't need that. I get it for the merch part. Cool. Right?
I mean, if anything, just sell Bray Wyatt merch. He's still gonna move.
I mean, as far Bray Wyatt merchandise is always gonna move. Like the Fiend merchandise is always gonna move. I don't ever expect that we will ever see something like the Fiend ever again. It's hard to ride coattails when for the longest time Bo Dallas had a better career than Bray Wyatt. So
yeah, NXT.
No, even when he got called up, all you gotta do is Bo leave.
That was
corn, but you know what? He had segments every week, he had matches every week, whereas Bray Wyatt did it. Bray Wyatt was still struggling to find a character. So I love the comments here that it could be Bo and Alexa, who's both of them are clear to come back, right? I love that idea. However, I don't want Bray Wyatt's his aura to continue to hover over Alexa Bliss at this point, right? Like Alexa did what she did with Bray. Now she needs to get back to being the goddess or another version of the goddess. But she's still relatively young. I don't even think she's, you know, in her mid-30s. I think she's in late 20s, maybe 30.
Here's the thing. It's unfortunate that Bray Wyatt had to pass away in order for this to be realized. But Undertaker created a character arc that now the wrestling fan needs. Bray Wyatt was going to feel that, was pretty much feeling that. You know, people were calling him the new Undertaker. You know, he called himself the new face of fear. And there was even a time where Undertaker kind of like gave him the rub, you know, because he knew that this was the direction. So my point in mentioning all of this is just that replacing that is going to be even more difficult, because like to put another person, even Sting, embodied a little bit of that when he was in WCW, and he's getting celebrated for those days, you know. Yeah. But like that kind of character where is demonic, for lack of a better phrase, I guess is just needed. You know, prior to Undertaker, I don't think we necessarily had it. Prior to 1990, I don't think the characters were like that. And, you know, Undertaker lasted for so long, you know, when Bray Wyatt is another character just like that. You know, Matt Hardy tried, but failed.
What Matt Hardy was able to do, in his sense of the Woken universe, he was able to restore the believability in comic book-like characters, right? Like, Taker got it. You know, Vince McMahon had us in a chokehold as far as characters goes in the 90s, right? Mm-hmm. And you know, WCW is in the war with that, and they try to slip in a little bit. Like, they tried with Glacier, trying to capitalize off the popularity of Mortal Kombat, but for some people, Glacier just didn't hit. I played Mortal Kombat way too much to be wanting to see Sub-Zero in a freaking wrestling ring, right?
So when they put him that the Mortal Kombat 3 Sub-Zero.
I didn't need that. But WWE has had a better sense in the grasp of being able to make a comic book character come to life, and it all starts with Taker, right? And you get Papa Shango, and you get the Boogeyman, and you get Mordecai. He wasn't really that great, but he was still a character, right? Which, you know, Kane and Undertaker, probably the best brother storyline of all time, because that story never stops. It never ends. But you know, Bray Wyatt and Matt Hardy to a lesser degree, they gave us believability back into supernatural things, right? And it starts with the cult leader of Bray Wyatt. Like, you know, it's something about the way that Bray moved that, and when they told where he got his character from and he and his nuances and the way he's doing his hands when he's talking and he's feeling out his, like, it's the equivalent of listening to a blind person sing or rap. Right, like you're feeling your words, you're feeling your cadences through everything, mm-hmm. and your body language tells it all. And that's what is something that was something so different about anybody doing promos. And then when you switch that and you give us a what was the match he had with Strowman at Extreme Rules, I think it was.
Oh yeah, that was a cinematic match as well.
Yes, right. So he pulled that from Matt Hardy, who Matt Hardy gave us the Ultimate Deletion, in which mm-hmm. we didn't even think about doing cinematic matches, but it works for the benefit of acting, and you can take cuts. And then Bray brings us the Firefly Funhouse and the Firefly Funhouse match, mm-hmm. right? And then the match that he had with Orton was where Orton burned down. What the hell is the match called? Damn, help me out, chat. What was the match that he had?
The when he was the Fiend, and then Alexa Bliss came out on the box. And
the match that him and Orton had, it was the assistant. God, man, I don't know what the match is called now, but it was a cinematic match. It was kind of like the Strowman match that they had where they were in the swamp, but they were in the house, like they were somewhere in the house that Randy ends up burning down. That was a cinematic match.
I can't,
Wyatt Rules. He had the Wyatt Rules match with New Day. That was pretty dope. I don't think that was a cinematic match, but I still think it was done in one take. But and going back into the premise of the whole conversation, I do think that Bo deserves to. He doesn't have to ride the coattails, but he can carry on his iteration of what he feels his brother would have done. And he mm-hmm. doesn't, and the last thing that he needs to do is rely on Bray's name so much, right? Like when coincidentally, we're about to talk about Rey Mysterio. Coincidentally, Rey kept giving us, Eddie Guerrero's name too much in his run before he became champion, you know? And then even after he became champion, it's still relying on Eddie to get that pop. And at that point, you didn't need to keep speaking about Eddie to get the pop. You're already over. But you take away the Eddie pop, and what do you have in Rey Mysterio? House of Horrors match. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. House of Horrors match. Damn, I could not for the life of me get that. And but
you know, the thing is, the funny thing is that Eddie died almost 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, the LWO thing, that's a homage to Eddie. You know, a lot of the stuff that Ray does is an homage to Eddie. Because Eddie put him on to a lot. And that, and in my opinion, when it comes to Eddie, the way that Ray is acting, I look at it as him just being Mexican, honestly. You know, but I do see what you mean, because even Chavo Guerrero has said it many times, like, all right, like, how many times are you going to just get the rub from Eddie? Like, come on now. You know, like, you know, all right, it's enough already. Like, how many times are you going to do that? And then the other thing with it is, you know, how much are we going to fault Dominic Mysterio from doing that? Because, you know, Eddie is one of the reasons why Dominic Mysterio was such a big heel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he said things, you know, like, look, mommy is always on top. Mommy is mommy because of I'm your boppy. You know what I mean? Like, Ray has used it. Dominic is using it. It's become a thing, because they know about the past. The kids, there's a whole bunch of kids that never even got to see Eddie Guerrero wrestle that know all about this stuff. And mind you, Eddie Guerrero still sells merch, and Vicky Guerrero still sells Eddie Guerrero merch. Like, you know, it's my point is just that, like Mexicans, they celebrate the Day of the Dead. You know, they're very, like, if you ever see somebody going to visit, like, somebody at a funeral or whatever, or at a cemetery, it's a squad of people. Like, it's just, they're very connected to the dead, right? So that's why I look at Rey Mysterio just being Mexican in a sense, but then at the same time, capitalizing off of the past, because he's doing it, Dominic is doing it, you know what I mean? And I think Dominic does a frog splash as well. I could be wrong. I think he does, you know. But, you know, Dominic is doing a 619, but then he's also doing, and no, he does the Three Amigos, Dominic. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, and then he has the Eddie haircut as well. You know what I'm saying? Like, no man in Gen Z is running around with a mohawk. Not with a mohawk, with a mullet. Wait, what's that shit called?
A mullet.
A mullet, thank you. With a mullet. Like, come on, bro. Who you think you are, Joe Dirt? Get out of here. For real. And Eddie pulled it off, and he pulled it off well. And mind you, Dominic looks a lot like Eddie. Like,
yeah,
with too the much. Freaking thing on.
Too much. And speaking of Rey Mysterio, he was in our main event of the evening, and AJ Styles, Kevin Owens, and Rey Mysterio for the winner to face LA Knight for the number one contendership, for the opportunity to go to France and face Cody Rhodes. And like I said before, AJ cuts a promo, one of his hottest promos as just this lone wolf 2.0 gimmick. And, you know, Kevin Owens, what he's doing right now is really good work in his career. But at the same time, it needs a little something else. Like, I just feel like Kevin's just coasting. But he knows how to still play to the crowd. But the crowd, I don't think the crowd is behind him the way they were when he was Universal Champion. I will say that, but and he's still getting over, but that's maybe just what I see. AJ Styles' new theme, I like it. It still has to grow on me. I get it. They Don't Want None has been a staple in WWE for like 8 years now, right? And I love it, but it's okay for this character arc. It doesn't appeal to the character that AJ is, right? like if you hear They Don't Want None, you're still associating AJ with the OC, and he's clearly not fucking with them right now, right? And they're like, okay, that's cool, we're about to go do our own thing. You know, Meechan's doing her own thing with the good brothers are inserting their stuff in the NXT, so that's cool for AJ, who's also mentioned that he knows that he's winding down in his career, which sucks, because I am a huge AJ Styles fan. But whenever somebody knows and they feel, then the end is probably near, is closer to the end than we expect. I believe that his world, you know, title picture days are over as well.
I
don't think he'll get the WWE championship, but he might get that the World Heavyweight Championship.
I don't think he even needs that, to tell you the truth. I mean, look, Kevin Owens number one is known to have to put in a quality match when necessary. Also, he's got some of the greatest mic skills in the business. You know, this guy is amazing on the mic, and he's had just about every belt, you know, so far. And he doesn't necessarily need it. to move the crowd. I mean, and then here's the thing. When he goes home, man, the crowd goes nuts.
Mm-hmm.
The crowd goes nuts when he's in Canada. At first, I mean, to be honest with you, I thought he was going to win this match. To have him go to France and just cut these, like, scathing promos of the French. Like when he fought Stone Cold, like, oh man, when he cut those promos on Texas, I was just like, man, of course, Kevin Owens. You know what I mean? Like that was great. I don't know. I'll always, you know, because the thing, me personally, what I like about Kevin Owens is the same thing I like about Bayley. He's a fan first. You know, he's been a fan for a long time, kind of like Edge and Christian with Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn are like the Edge and Christian of today. You know what I mean? Because were fans and they do all of this stuff. I think that Kevin Owens would be good as a champion if he was a heel again.
Yeah.
You know, he was a heel and he just, like, when he was United States champion type of thing, I think that's when it's good to put a belt on Kevin Owens. But Kevin Owens as a face, nah. Just needs a mic, makes to make fun of somebody. I like the whole double punch thing that he did with Grayson Waller and them. That was cool. You know, this whole thing with Logan Paul, I thought it was cool, you know, because he knows how to go back and forth and talk. Like, he doesn't, I really don't think he needs a belt. I really don't. You know what I mean? He's and then he has his loyal fan base. You know, he always makes a KO Mania shirt for every Mania. I think this was KO Mania 7 that just came out. Mike would know because Mike collects old shirts.
He's a big KO Mania shirt fan.
You know what I mean? So, like, but my point is just that he has this thing. And then, mind you, there's a lot of people that would love to see him in AEW. So now, and then speaking of that,
listen, AEW fans would love to get anybody from WWE at this point
but here's the funny thing. The reason I say this is, I don't know if you noticed, but yesterday when he picked up that Detroit Tigers belt, there was a CM Punk shirt on the table that he just like threw down. Right. So, I wonder if, you know, especially now that Tony Khan, quote unquote, crossed the line by bringing all that shit up, I wonder if they'll put Kevin Owens and CM Punk together. I wonder, because there's definitely beef. You know, look, I remember one time when Adam Cole went to the hospital and Kevin Owens was just like, hey, I want to give a shout out to my friend Adam. And you know what I mean? Everybody knew what he was doing. But, you know, he cleaned it up well. And then when CM Punk first arrived, there was a little thing between Kevin Owens and CM Punk that they didn't look too friendly. Right? So now yesterday I noticed how Kevin Owens just threw that CM Punk shirt to the floor. So I don't know if that was natural or if that was a thing. You know what I mean? But anyway, I'm going in on Kevin Owens. But yeah, man, it was cool stuff. It's cool stuff.
As Booker T would say, oh yeah, man.
That's right. Now,
oh yeah.
But here was the crazy thing though, because this match was ill. The way that the match ended.
Leon, happy Saturday, my brother. Thank you for stopping by the penitentiary.
Thanks. You saw how the match ended?
Yeah.
With that Styles clash on the top rope?
Yeah.
I don't think you could do that with anybody else but Rey Mysterio. So shout out to Rey Mysterio.
No, you can't.
For real. Like,
you can't.
I don't think AJ Styles could hold anybody else like that. Like that was crazy. I mean, shout out to both of them because Kevin Owens took it from with both of them landed on him. And like, you know what I mean? But I don't think you could get away. I don't think AJ Styles could get away with some shit like that with anybody else.
No, absolutely not. You can't. But I think the match was really good. I think for what we got last night, to follow up from what Raw produced, what NXT produced. I thought that SmackDown in its own right, they made a claim for their brand and the style of television that they put on, right? Because all of the brands are very, very much different, right? Mm-hmm. And it depends on how it's presented to us. So literally, I don't know if you saw the chat, right? But Mike does the post. He does the post-Mania show, and me and Vinny are doing it with him. And and then, you know, Jack and Barb do the NXT, really good numbers, right? AEW does the CM Punk footage, their numbers shoot through the roof. I'm like, I look at this shit and I'm like, listen, SmackDown better give me something, because this shit that we gotta follow up on this week. Oh gosh. But you know what? This SmackDown was very good. It was very entertaining. I think it kept on pace with everything that happened in pro wrestling. And after the main event, we get what we're going to get is LA Knight AJ 2. I'm all for this.
They had a good match at Mania.
Mania was a good match. And for those that you know, who didn't like the Jay and Jimmy, right? They didn't like Jay and Jimmy. I love Jay and Jimmy because it told the story of the little brother overcoming the big brother. And it wasn't, I don't think it was meant to be a wrestling match. And I think that's the disconnect with most people that didn't like it. It wasn't meant to be a wrestling match. It was supposed to be a brawl. It was supposed to be unorthodox of family members fighting, not wrestling. They never said that they wanted to wrestle. What did Jay say? I'm going to knock the yeet out your ass.
You know what the problem with that match is? The problem with the yeet and no yeet is that it was compared to Bret Hart versus Owen Hart.
You can't. I mean, I get that. I'm one of the people, and I said this on Monday. It did give me Bret and Owen, because you look at Bret and Owen, they are submission technicians, suplex technicians. They are very calculated in the ring. Depending on which style of brother that you like, that's your favorite one, right? And it's the same thing. But on the other side of the spectrum, the Usos are strikers. They're whose style of striking do you like more? You know, and whose emotion do you like more? Jimmy doesn't give you very much emotion. Jay gives you all the emotion all the time, but their match.
I mean, but wait a minute. Do you remember that match?
With Jay and
Jimmy? Match between Owen and
Owen Brett? And Owen Brett? Yeah. I just got done watching mostly all the Manias. Okay. It's one of my favorite matches of all time.
So I mean, it's hard to, because people were comparing it to that. People were comparing it to Matt to Jeff.
Matt and Jeff was trash. Matt and Jeff. If y'all gonna say Jay and Jimmy was trash, Matt and Jeff was trash. And
it was
the story between Matt.
But my point is,
wasn't close.
My point in saying all of that is just that I feel like the expectations were too high. I feel like a lot of people felt like this was the end of a story, as opposed to the continuance of a story. Because now we can see that match was part of the story. Maybe they're going to have more matches. Maybe that's going to be the one and only, right? But
oh, yeah, it's
unfortunately, there was a lot of sizzle and very little steak.
Yeah, yep, I get it. But it sucks that it's Mania that you have to say, just wait and see, right? It sucks that it was, you know what I'm saying? Like, it just sucks that that's what it was. But still, you had one of the most over faces in the company, in which Mike says that Jay is the most over face. I will agree with him, but I am a Jay Uso mark. Going back to LA and AJ at Mania, AJ. Yo, Leon, chill. Yo, I forgot about that. He ran over in a car. Going back to LA and AJ, right? Their Mania match was good. It was what most people will want Jay and Jimmy to be. And for a lot of people who were invested in this feud, and remember, we didn't particularly like this setup for a number of weeks until the house invasion. Then we both got more invested in this match, and this actually turned out to be one of the good matches on the card, but it was a little short. It was a little short. I anticipate the one that they do next Friday will be, like or as maybe better than their Mania match, and which is fine. Like if it's a one off, you always want the one off to be top notch, right? Like I don't want to see another AJ versus Randy unless it's so, you know, there can be a get back. But you know, if we're doing that type of style. But at this point in their careers, I don't think that that's a thing. You just want to be even because we don't know what happens at the draft. We don't know where people are going. We don't know what titles are switching. We don't know anything. And this is the good thing about where we're going in this Triple H era. And Leon says that he's really liking this new era, and it feels like wrestling again. Right. Like anytime that I can get some of my partial friends who don't necessarily like wrestling to indulge and converse with me, then I know that wrestling is interesting again. Right. Like wrestling has captured people again, and they're talking about it. And it's not just on social media. It's in media outlets, and it's not news outlets. It's TV shows. It's music videos. It's everything else but what it should be. Overall, I'm going to say SmackDown was a really, really good SmackDown. One thing I did not touch on, and I wanted to touch on it because it kind of was trash to touch on, but we get a Bron Breakker sighting versus Cameron Grimes. I don't know why Cameron Grimes is even there.
And that's crazy because it goes to show you Cameron Grimes was having a major feud with LA Knight over the $1 million championship. Ted DiBiase was involved. And, you know, they were pushing the guy to the moon. But now he's a jobber for Bron Breakker.
Yeah. As soon as I seen Cameron Grimes in the ring, I knew it was trouble. I just completely forgot that Bron Breakker was going to SmackDown because he did do a farewell speech after him and Corbin had lost the titles. So it's very unfortunate. If we're talking about mid-carders in WWE, Cameron Grimes is destined to be a mid-carder for life, and there is no main event potential for him. You might as well add him to a faction and let him, you know, circle the mid card of that faction, and he can look strong or at least respectable. But quick work of Cameron Grimes, in which Bron Breakker is going to be a star. I saw Jeffrey was saying that they didn't said in Jeffrey were saying that they didn't like the change in Bron Breakker's music. But keeping the sirens, you gotta keep the sirens because the man sounds just like his damn uncle. He's, you know, he's built like his daddy, sounds like his uncle. And he just has it between his family. He just has it. So when you hear that siren, it makes you think of a big Papa Pump. And I thought I was about to hear Holly if you hear me for a minute, right? And he comes out and he's looking like both of them. He looks like money. I can't wait to see what his first big main event feud is. But for right now, continue to build him up. If we're gonna allow squash matches, if we're gonna complain about squash matches for Jade, let's complain about squash matches for Bron Breakker. I hear crickets when that comparison is there. But again, overall, really good, really, really good SmackDown for the post WrestleMania edition. I'm excited to see what happens in the Triple H era. I am excited to see what happens in the draft. Jordynne Grace does have the sirens, who is a protege of Big Papa Pump, Thick Mama Pump, but now she's just muscular as shit, and it just disturbs me. It's really disturbing how much she just changed her body. But self-love is real. But overall, how would you rate the night? What is your favorite part about SmackDown last night?
Well, my favorite part of SmackDown was seeing everything with Solo Sikoa, because everything else seemed pretty predictable. Like, as far as what happens in France, I think it's going to be AJ Styles versus Cody Rhodes. I think that next week they're going to set up AJ and LA Knight to fight, where AJ will win by cheating, and then go on to France and be the big bad guy. I highly doubt that they're going to put LA Knight to go to France to with all the momentum that he has to be the bad guy and face Cody Rhodes. I'm Tama Tonga showing up, which was the worst kept secret in the wrestling business, in the wrestling industry. Him showing up was a plus. Just seeing Jade Cargill is always a plus. But my favorite thing was, more than anything, is just seeing Paul Heyman and his reaction to Solo Sikoa.
Cool. So when you say the Undertaker of this generation, and we got about 4 minutes before we end the show, you got to give me more. Undertaker in terms of streak, in terms of aura, in terms of
character. There was no other person that could do that but Bray Wyatt.
Yep, and we lost him, which is unfortunate. And a lot of people, just as he, Undertaker, came to hindsight and said that he should have ended the streak of, Bray Wyatt should have ended the streak, but Taker was dealing with a time where he was questioning if he could still go. If I'm not mistaken, this was off the heels of the terrible Goldberg shit. Like, I think it was like before then, he had three matches like back to back to back that were fucking duds, right? So he should have kept going with that momentum and just passed the torch to Bray. You should have ended, if you still wanted to go after Bray and let Bray take out the dead man, and you can still do the American Badass, but dead man is done, right? And EC touched on this in the chat, and he says that, Undertaker said that, the dead man is done. He will only come back as the American Badass. That's why we saw that iteration of him at Mania. But it's really hard when you're talking in terms of supernatural character, because Bray was the closest thing that we had to Taker. I think that they tried to do something with Joe Gacy and Schism, but it just became super value, low budget.
I think that the audience is different now, and I don't think you can get away with so much supernatural stuff like you did before.
The crowd has to allow themselves to let go and just indulge it, in my opinion. Right? That's what made the Fiend so believable. And we know the Fiend is just a person with a mask, right? But the mask was so lifelike and it looks so real because, it's a mask. But literally the shackles on the side made you think that it was attached to his face and not just like a clip-on in the back. Like it was a perfectly constructed mask that you knew that, it's a person there, but like, it would really look like a person, right? So we have to allow ourselves as wrestling fans just to sit back and just take in what is being presented and stop trying to look for the backstage stuff before the presentation has even started.
No, but here's the thing, though. Because of Bray Wyatt and his character prior to The Fiend, that's why it worked. And all those promos that he did, like, the guy was one of the best promo people in the company. And the thing about Bray Wyatt's promos is that a lot of times he was cutting promos on the fans. He was cutting promos on just, like, society. You know what I mean? Like, he was just saying things that were real. If you really, like, sit down and pay attention to them, and it was just creepy. Everything about him was just, right.
Yeah.
I mean? Like, everything. And that's why, like, I think that The Fiend really, really worked because of the build to it. You know what I'm saying? And that's why, like, I think it probably can happen again. It probably can. But it's definitely going to take a while. And I certainly don't see any character that has that whole thing. You know, I mean, the Undertaker is a once in a lifetime thing, in my opinion, because of the timing, because of all of that. Bray Wyatt, or because of who he was and his ideas, that's why it worked. But I certainly don't see that. And I'm sad to say I don't see it happening again, but I hope it does.
Yeah, listen, before we get up out of here, everybody, first and foremost, I want to thank all of y'all for all of your engagements and all of our shows this week. This is the new start of the WWE season, and we have started off hot. Everybody, all of my UPR counterparts, from, you know, EC, Big Mike Knox, Bad Guy Jack, Barbara, Dan the Man, Vinny, shout out to the two guests that they had on the show, and of course my co-host Vic here. I've been pushing all this week, telling people, let's get the content out, all hands on deck. We are starting a new WWE season, new season of professional wrestling, if you will. So that means we get to rebrand and we get to show off ourselves in a stronger light and pushing this thing. We are moving the subscribers on YouTube. Let's keep those numbers running. It doesn't cost you anything to just like it, share. You guys pop in and you comment. This is the reason why we are supposed to have a 1 hour show, maybe an hour 20. We go an extra hour. We go an extra 40 minutes because you guys in the chat keep the conversation going. You keep it interesting. If it was just me rambling on by myself, without my co-host here, you guys would have been gone. So thank you. Thank you. Moving on with our shows, we have next up AEW Collision tonight. I believe we don't know who's going to be on there. They can't figure anything out. Then on Monday, the Mike Knox Show starts the week off Monday, 6 p.m. And right after Raw, you're going to get the Monday Night Raw review. Tuesday with Bad Guy Jack and Wrestling Doll on the NXT Review and Results Show. AEW on Wednesday, Dan the Man, Vinny, La Spada. And then you can check out Friday Night SmackDown. On Friday, you come to us on noon. You come to us noon and we're going to give you this hot fire every time, every single time we come in here. So for my co-host Vic, I am Nazia Salin, and I just like to say thank you guys for stopping by, and as always,
welcome to the SmackDown Penitentiary.